Good evening, everybody. Welcome back to Hillcrest Baptist Church. Good to see you all here this evening. Let's begin by standing together. If you want to take the songbook located next to you, find page number 23. Page 23. We'll sing all four stanzas. There is power, wonderful working power in the blood. Let's all stand and sing together. Jesus, would you say amen? And you're singing like it as well. Thank you so much for singing. Please be seated. And we're off to a great start tonight. Want to welcome each and every one of you to Hillcrest Baptist Church. Welcome all those watching via live stream as well. Trust you had a great afternoon, had a chance to get some rest. And I know there's a lot of things going on tonight, especially here in Phoenix. Very important, game seven. And so I told our guests who are coming, our guest speaker, I say, if you hear us amening and smiling at you while you're singing and preaching, it's because we're checking the score and the dings are going off and the Suns are winning. And I said, if we're frowning and we're not smiling, it's not because we don't like what you're saying, it's because we're getting whooped in game seven. But I appreciate you being here, whoever gets the trophy this year, that's just a temporal trophy. We understand the things that are accomplished in this place and in churches all across our state, churches all across the world, are things that count for eternity as we open up the Word of God, as we listen to it, as we make decisions based on the Word of God. And so thank you for being in the right place tonight. Sure do hope our service is a blessing to you. With that in mind, we do have numbers of guests who are with us today. We have some special guests from California that we'll introduce here in just a moment, and we have some of their family who's coming to be a part of our service, and so thank you so much for coming tonight. And then we also have a dear friend of our church and our ministry, Pastor Mark Hoffer, the pastor of Liberty Baptist Church up in Prescott, Arizona. His church has supported our church, helped us get going through from the foundation, from the start of it, And Brother Schwenke was just up there a couple weeks ago, I think last week for Mother's Day, did a revival meeting. And so we prayed for that revival meeting in our Wednesday night Bible study, mentioned you and your church, and really just did a nice surprise for us as he came in to be a part of our service. He's down here in Phoenix and visited one of our sister churches in Glendale. And he said, yeah, I was hoping to hear the pastor preach, and they had a guest speaker. And so he comes over here tonight, and we have another guest speaker. And so, hopefully, so everybody kind of gets the night off tonight. But Pastor Hoffer, thank you for your friendship. Thank you for your church's support of our ministry, and sure to count it an honor to know you, and your church has been a blessing to us, so thank you for being here tonight as well. Our special guests from California are the Harvest Trio from Lancaster, California, West Coast Baptist College. And in a moment, they're going to come and sing some songs from us. But I would like to tell just a quick story about their leader who is with them tonight and the man who will be preaching for us. I don't know if he remembers, kind of have to go down memory lane a little bit, but really close to 15 years ago, almost 15 years ago, I was a, you know, young, strapping senior in high school and knew that the Lord had called me to preach, knew that wanting to serve the Lord with my life somewhere, just wasn't quite sure where God had me to go and train from Bible college. And so the week of my senior prom, my dad and myself and another friend of mine and his dad, we all got plane tickets, and we went out from where I grew up in South Carolina to California to look at West Coast Baptist College. And that the first day that we were there, we went out to lunch with one of the staff members, and there's a young couple that was there eating with us, and it was the man who will be speaking for us tonight, Brother Daniel Blehm, and his wife, Miss Sarah Blehm, and they were training to be on the staff there, and then they took us to the airport the next day. And so I reminded my father about that. I said, I guess it turns out you were my date for my senior prom. And he said, I don't know if who many other people can say that. And I said, yeah, I haven't really publicized that because I don't know if I want to publicize that. But now, that was almost 15, about 14 years ago. And now Brother Blehm gets to come to our church. So I was super excited to see him come be here and be bringing the Word of God to us tonight. But right before he does that and share some things about the college, I'm going to ask the Harvest Trio if they'd come and prepare to sing. And while they do that, church, let me remind us that we are here to worship the Lord tonight, give God the praise and worship Him in the beauty of His holiness. And so you smile at these singers as they sing. If you want to give God a hand clap of praise at the end of the song, that's perfectly all right here. If you want to say amen, that simply means we agree what you're saying is truth. And so let's just have a good time tonight. Let's enjoy one another, enjoy the Lord, and worship Him tonight. But you join me in welcoming the Harvest Trio to Hillcrest Baptist Church.
Good evening. As Pastor said, we are the Harvest Trio from West Coast Baptist College, and it's our pleasure to be with you tonight. My name is Luke Jimenez. I am from Raleigh, North Carolina, and I will be a sophomore this year studying pastoral theology.
Hi, everyone. My name is Violet Wardlaw, and I'm a junior from San Diego, California, studying secondary education.
Aloha. My name is Lehunani Luce, and I'm from Eva Beach, Hawaii, from the island of Oahu, and I'm a senior studying music education.
And on the piano is Aiden Beckwith. Aiden is from Redding, California. He is also a sophomore studying pastoral theology.
God is worthy, worthy of praise, worthy of glory. So I'll bless His name, and His mercies are new every day. With all of my heart, soul, and strength, I will say, God is worthy, worthy of praise. Before the foundation of earth was laid, God was worthy of praise. When He spoke the word and the world was framed, God was worthy of praise. Through the ages, true and changeless, all nations I proclaim, God is worthy, worthy of praise, worthy of glory. So I'll bless His name, and His mercies are new every day. With all of my heart, soul, and strength, I will say, God is worthy, worthy of praise. Atonement for sin, God was worthy of praise. When the tomb was empty and death could not win, God was worthy of praise. I will honor my Redeemer, and forever I'll proclaim, God is worthy, worthy of praise, worthy of glory. So I'll bless His name, and His mercies are new every day. With all of my heart, soul, and strength, I will say, God is worthy, worthy of praise. Omnipotent and holy, He reigns upon His throne, yet His great Jesus is all. God is worthy, worthy of praise, worthy of glory. So I'll bless his name and his mercies are new every day. With all of my heart, soul, and strength I will say, God is worthy, worthy of praise. With all of my heart, soul, and strength I will say, God is worthy, worthy of praise. Worthy of praise. Only words to me, red letters on a page, just something people say, till it brought me to my knees. Those words in John 3:16, for God so loved the world he gave his only son away, away to save a wretch like me. The one who needed grace to cover every stains that he no longer sees. It's amazing to believe that God so loved the world means he. I've seen what mercy does. He found me where I was, and he gave his life for mine. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son away, away to save a wretch like me. The one who needed grace to cover every stains that he no longer sees. It's amazing to believe that God so loved the world means even me. Me with all my failures, me with all my shame, it's the very reason Jesus came. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son away, away to save a wretch like me. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son away, away to save a wretch like me. One who needed grace to cover every stains that he no longer sees. It's amazing to believe, it's so amazing to believe, that God so loved the world means he.
Aren't you glad that the whole world includes you and me? And what a blessing. And I know some of the other songs that they're going to be singing tonight and will be also a special blessing to you. But greetings from Lancaster, California, West Coast Baptist College. And we send our greetings with our pastor, Dr. Paul Chappell, and the staff members there. And Pastor, I feel so at home. You put Hollywood right at the front just for us. And we just feel right at home here and so appreciative of thinking about that on our behalf. And Lancaster, for those of you that don't know where that's at, it is located about an hour to the northeast of Los Angeles. So if you can picture where Los Angeles is, right there in the kind of the Southern California area, and go out where nobody else wants to go, called the desert, and that's where you'll find us. And but you all know what the desert's all about because you are in one too. And I flew in yesterday from Los Angeles into Tucson. I left 94 degree weather. I came to 99 degree weather. And so I don't know why everybody flies south for the winter. And those of you that have snowbirds and things like that, I'm sure it's a lot more enjoyable during the winter months. But it is a blessing to be with you tonight. And your pastor and his dear wife are such good friends of ours. And it's it warms my heart just to think about when he came as a student, she came as a student, and to see what God is doing in their lives and to be introduced to the next generation of Crittendens. And what a blessing that is as well. And you, Pastor, are doing a wonderful job. And keep on keeping on. And church family, you've got a wonderful pastor and pastor's wife. And I want to encourage you to continue to love on them and just some precious people. Well, just a real quick, brief synopsis. West Coast Baptist College exists to train laborers for the harvest field. And the Bible tells us that the fields are white unto harvest. And the Lord had a prayer request. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers. And the Lord is doing it as long as we are answering that call. And there are young people and old people alike that are answering the call to go out into the harvest fields all over the world. We just had our 26th graduating class, I believe, and saw close to 200, I believe, folks that graduated, and some that did them online, some that did it on campus. And it's just amazing how God is expanding the borders of even the ministry of West Coast Baptist College. We just celebrated our 1,000th graduate from the college in the past 27 years. And Dr. Getch, who's our executive vice president, says often that the sun never sets on a West Coast Baptist College graduate somewhere in the world. And we've got even some right now serving in Russia, Ukraine, and all over the parts of Europe and even Africa. And we just had several of them that just returned from a missions trip just yesterday from Mexico that headed down there right after graduation. And then you get to see a sampling of some of the young people as we've brought some along with us that have given up their entire summer to just go church to church and just to be a blessing just like they are tonight. And you must be smiling really good at them because they're sounding really good tonight too. So you keep doing whatever it is that you're doing. If you're smiling at them or frowning at them, it's working. So keep doing it. And they're doing a great job. And I trust you'll get a chance to meet them and get to know them just a little bit and to hear their story, to hear their testimony, and just some wonderful choice servants of the Lord. And again, ask them any question you want to know. Ask them what classes they're taking. Ask them about the online programs that are there to be offered. Whether you're an 18-year-old or an 89-year-old, there might be something there for you and that we can offer unto you that the Lord would use in your life or in your church here. But ask them questions. Ask them if they're dating. Ask them if they're engaged. Ask them if there's anybody on the horizon. You know, put them in an embarrassing spot like that just to see what kind of answers you might get. Or you can always do the casual, how's the food there, right? That's always a good one that people want to know. And so you get a chance to ask them some questions, and I know that they would enjoy getting to speak with you tonight. Well, we did bring a table with us. And on the table, there's some great materials that I want to encourage you to get your hands on. And this would be just a wealth of information by way of just some tools that you can put into your own spiritual life, or maybe just by way of a gift that you could give to somebody. Maybe you've got a graduate on the horizon, and instead of just giving them the $20 bill and a gift card or something like that, maybe give them something that would help to sharpen them, help to encourage them along spiritual lines. And I wanted to just highlight just a few of them, if I could, just very briefly. And the first one I want to highlight is if you enjoyed the two songs you just heard, and if you're going to enjoy the other songs you're about to hear, you can get some of those songs on this brand new CD and simply entitled The Only Worthy King. And it is brand new, hot off the press. It just came out just 2 weeks ago at our graduation. And the group you just heard is singing one of the songs on here, as well as our choir and various other ensembles. And just a really good CD. Would encourage it. The group was singing along with it as we were pulling into the driveway here just to warm their voices up. And so that's a stamp of approval that if they like it, you should get it, right? And so come get that. That's a new CD. And there's also some other older CDs from past groups and past years. There's one over there that's a men's quartet CD, just all men's quartet. There's one that's just instrumental. So it's got violin and acoustic guitar with some piano and different things. And so that might be something that would be right up your alley as you're studying or working around the house. Or maybe if your traffic's anything like Lancaster traffic or Los Angeles traffic, you might need something to listen to in the car to keep you spiritual. And so we want to encourage you to get some of those materials. We also have some books. And this one is a great book that was written by one of our deacons at the church that just recently retired from the military service. And what he has done is he's gone through and picked just military history type stories, and he's compiled them into a devotional book format with correlating passages of scripture to bring out maybe a truth from that story that correlates to scripture. And this is just a great devotional book, and it would be a great gift idea if you have maybe a veteran or maybe you know somebody that was in the military. This would be a great connection point for them. Or if you're a history buff and you just like things about history, this would be a great kind of aid to your study to just maybe kind of just encourage you along the lines of history or our current history. And so this is available. It's simply entitled Boots on the Ground, 365 Devotions there, and something that you could pass on from family member to family member if you wanted. And then our pastor, Dr. Paul Chappell, wrote a book and simply entitled Outsiders. And what he did is he went through and he researched 15 different what we would call heroes of the faith in previous generations that stood for their faith, that many of them died being persecuted for their faith because their culture was trying to cancel them, their culture was trying to squash them, their culture was persecuting them to stop speaking in the name of Christ, and yet they stood in the face of that persecution and were found faithful even unto death. And it's because of their testimony that we even have the privilege of meeting together tonight, or that we have a Bible in our hands. Though Satan was attacking the church, God's people stood firm. And you know what? Right now we're living in a society where they're trying to cancel us, they're trying to squash us, they're trying to persecute us, and I can only just imagine that maybe persecution in America is not too far down the road in our future, and this might be a challenging, encouraging storybook of lives, real people that took a stand against their culture, and their lives were blessed for it. Though they might have paid the ultimate price, we can now read about them because they were difference makers in their generation. And I want to challenge all of us to be a difference maker in our generation and to maybe be an outsider compared to that of culture. And so this would be a great book, just a great, fantastic read. Our pastor challenged our youth group there in Lancaster about 2 years ago that if any of the teenagers would pick up a copy and do that as their summer reading while they were off of school, that he would do something special for them. And he had about 40 to 50 of our young people that took him up on that and read it as their summer reading. And maybe you're a mom or a dad, or maybe you're a grandparent, and you're thinking, man, instead of my kid or my grandkid sleeping their summer away after school ends, maybe I'll get something like that for them and give it to them as a gift, and maybe even as a challenge of, hey, I'll give you $20 if you read that whole book. And you know what? That'd be a $20 well invested. And so I want to encourage you on that one. And then men, I've got a book for you men. Men, this is one of the newest books that we have out by our ministry, and it's just for us men. It was written by our pastor's wife, Miss Terry Chappell, right to us men, and you need to grab you a copy because it will help to enlarge your borders. And it is just as simply entitled Heartfelt Hospitality, and it is a beautiful cookbook that you can buy for that special someone in your life, and you can give that to them and say, honey, can we try out some of these recipes? And this will help just our family life. This will help our home life. And that might just be a gift idea that you might get for your wife. But this is a wonderful book. Just came out right about 8 months ago, 9 months ago. and just really the first opening chapters just talk about how you and I should just have that hospitality that the first century church was known for, that they were breaking bread from house to house. They were inviting people over. I'm not too old to remember when we actually used to know who our neighbors were, and we would actually borrow cups of sugar from each other and not hide from each other when we got home, right? That's today's culture. And yet, how can we change that? How can we make a difference? By showing people our love one for another. And so this might be just a great idea. The opening chapters, again, would just be a help to you, just a challenge to you of how to be hospitable and how to open up your home and just kind of some things to think through. Again, we're being funny about the recipes, but they are good, but they will enlarge your coast or your influence, if you know what I'm talking about, if you eat all of the recipes, as is mentioned. But I want to encourage you just to come by. This is a great gift idea as well. And time does not allow to mention all of the books or CDs over there, and I wish I could. There's some great ones there, some other devotionals. There's some ladies' devotionals. There's some shorter books, smaller books that would be great for just a gift idea as well. But if there's anything we can do to help you out by way of those gifts, the ladies will be over there at the table. The guys will be around to answer questions. We do take cash. We do take check. We do take a credit card. I made the joke this morning down there in Sierra Vista that we used to take small children, but small children end up growing up into bigger children, and they cost a lot more to feed, and we started running out of space in the van, and so we stopped taking children a few years ago. Anyways, if we can be a help to you, please let us know. And Pastor, thank you so much for allowing us to come. And on behalf of Pastor Chapel, we've got a small gift for you and your wife that we'll get to you right after the service is over. But again, thank you so much for the privilege of being here. And I believe at this time the group's going to come again, and they're going to sing a few more songs. And whatever it was that you were doing the first time around, you do that again and let them sing and minister to your heart, and you encourage them along, and then we'll come up and do a message in just a moment or two.
The sin and shame of all mankind, and as he hung there dying, I was on his mind. His sacrifice and love some don't appreciate, but I would like to speak and set the record straight.
That's my God, and I love him. That's my Jesus, he died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say loud and clear, that's my God. Some say he's nothing more than a fairy tale. He's just a myth or legend. His presence is not real.
His word is not correct politically. They curse and mock his name defiantly.
Oh, but time has never changed the changeless one. Their lies cannot disprove the existence of God's Son. Though some may be content to just sit by, I for one must stand and testify. That's my God, and I love him. That's my Jesus, he died for me. For all the world to hear,
I'll say it loud and clear, that's my God. That's my God, and I love Him. That's my Jesus, He died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say it loud and clear, that's my God. That's my God.
Near the cross I stand, troubled heart and trembling hand. Knowing all that I have done, do I dare to even come?
Near the cross I fall, no more strength to undeterred, knowing I do not deserve to be near the cross at all. In the shadow of the cross, humbly I surrender all. Lord, may I be shadow of the cross. Near the cross I pray.
Near the cross I pray.
Draw me nearer every day.
Draw me nearer every day.
Bring His pain before my eyes. May I not forget the price.
Near the cross I plead.
Near the cross I plead.
No more fighting I concede.
No more fighting I concede. Though my heart is full of fear, bringing all that I hold dear, lay it down and set it free. In the shadow of the cross, surrender all. Lord, may I be ever lost in the shadow of the cross.
But drops of grief can't ne'er repay the debt of love I owe.
Dear Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do. In the shadow of the cross, humbly I surrender all. Lord, may I be ever lost in the shadow. Still I marvel at your worth, knowing I do not deserve to be near the cross at all.
Amen. Well, thank you, group, for singing tonight, and thank you, church family, for, again, the privilege of being able to be with you tonight. Thank you, guests and visitors that are here And I want to challenge you, if you have the opportunity to be back again next week, I would encourage you to do so and to be right here and in your place and get to hear Pastor. But what a privilege to be able to stand before you tonight and to open up God's Word. And I'm not a tenured servant of the Lord by way of years and years and years of ministry. And it's only maybe on one hand that I can count the opportunities that I have had the privilege of being able to preach for what would be a former student. And this is only one of those times. And I count that a great privilege and a great joy. And it just thrills my heart to be able to see the next generation coming behind and staying faithful to the Lord. And Pastor, what a blessing. And thank you so much for the privilege tonight to be in your pulpit. And what a blessing there. Well, if you have your Bibles, Matthew chapter number 5 tonight, and we won't plan on being long tonight, but we do want to just point out just a few simple things tonight out of God's Word, and then I'll let you go watch Game 7. How's that sound? No, you're not that worried about it. Good. Then I won't preach as long as I was planning to preach, but I will bring some thoughts here from the Word of God. Matthew chapter number 5, and most of us know this account, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, is simply the Sermon on the Mount, and where Jesus himself was teaching his disciples. Now, his disciples at this time was not just those apostles. We believe it was a much larger crowd, and about 4 years ago, 2018, I had the privilege of standing in this area and being able to, there in Israel, to be able to hear the projection of the sound of a voice coming off of the hillside there, just outside of the Sea of Galilee, and what a privilege that was. And in fact, our pastor and many of our church members are actually in Israel, even as we speak tonight, and having an opportunity just to view the Holy Land. And if you ever have that opportunity or that privilege, let me challenge you to take it and run with it, because it will change the perspective that you have. It'll just make God's Word just come that much more alive to you when you can actually picture it and see it. I grew up in Colorado. That's where I was born and raised. If you hear an accent tonight, that is from my time in Oklahoma, so don't hold it against me. But in Colorado, we have what is known as the Rocky Mountains. How many of you have ever visited the Rocky Mountains? Maybe driving through, maybe you've seen pictures of it. You know, it's one thing to read about the Rocky Mountains. It's an entirely different thing to experience the Rocky Mountains. I mean, words cannot describe fully how beautiful God's creation is until you see it. That's why they say a picture is worth a thousand words, right? And nothing at all against the written Word of God by any means. But man, when you can put some pictures to it, when you can put some scenery to the stories, when you can kind of realize the distance that you're talking about by way of walking, not by way of a car, it just revitalizes and changes your perspective of God's Word, and it gives you that now picture that's worth a thousand words when you're reading the Scripture. And that's what it was for me when I stood on that hillside, and as I was maybe about, 75 yards away from the man that was selected to go up on the hillside and just begin to speak to us, and he was not speaking any louder than a conversational tone, and it was just carrying for all of us in that group to hear, and it was just absolutely amazing. And of course, the backdrop of the Sea of Galilee right behind you, and just to think of some of the biblical events that took place there, it was just absolutely amazing. But not as amazing as what these individuals would have experienced that day, as they had the privilege of hearing the Lord Jesus Christ speaking unto them this Sermon on the Mount. And that's with that thought in mind, I want to look here and see what the Lord Jesus Christ was telling his disciples, and I believe what he could be telling us even tonight. You have your Bibles, Matthew chapter number 5, and for sake of time, for sake of reading, we'll just read just a few verses here. But verse number 1, and seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth, and he taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Verse number 11, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice. Wait, stop, look up here. That was contrary to anything that they had heard before. Wait a second, that's contrary to anything you and I have heard before if we've not grown up in a Bible-believing church. Why, if somebody pokes you, you poke them back, right? If you're going to do me wrong, I'm going to do you wrong. That's natural human instinct. And yet the Lord Jesus Christ is telling this multitude of people that when somebody persecutes you, that you're to turn the other cheek. When people come against you, that you're to be a peacemaker. I mean, this is counterculture compared to what they would have known. And yet he says here that you would be blessed and that you should rejoice, verse number 12, and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt had lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Father, we thank you for the night, and we thank you for the good singing from the group, and Lord, thank you for the guests and the visitors that you brought our way. Thank you for Pastor Crittenden and his wonderful, wonderful family, and Lord, just the privilege of, Lord, just seeing what you have done in these 4 years here, and just to hear of the stories of God's grace and the lives that have been changed, and the testimony of what a man stepping out in faith with his family and being totally surrendered to you, what you can do, even in the midst of trial and even in the midst of a global pandemic, that you, Lord, are at work. And we just want to stop and say thank you tonight. Thank you that we have this privilege. Well, others, Lord, that maybe perhaps are a little bit more tuned to the things of the world would maybe not even consider being in a church service on a Sunday night, yet here sits a group that, Lord, I believe wants to hear from you tonight. Lord, we've enjoyed the singing, no doubt. We've enjoyed the testimony and song. But, Lord, how I pray that you would now cleanse us from, Lord, anything that would hinder us, Lord, from hearing from you. And I pray that you would use these lips to speak your truth tonight. And, Lord, that you would do a work that only your Holy Spirit can do in each life. And I pray, Lord, that when all is said and done, that we would not just be hearers, but that we would be doers of that which we hear tonight. For it's in thy Son's precious name we ask these things, for he alone is worthy. Amen. I have the privilege back in Lancaster. I have two children of my own and a wonderful wife of now close to 15 years. We'll celebrate our anniversary while I'm on the road, and so I won't get to celebrate it with her, but we'll be celebrating our 15th anniversary, and God's blessed us with some wonderful kids. I've got a 9-year-old daughter, and I've got a 7-year-old son. Now, my 7-year-old son, he is just now getting to the age of being in first grade. Last year was his first year of playing T-ball, so he played T-ball last year, and old dad got the chance to coach the T-ball team. And Pastor, it's like herding cats. You've got all these kindergartners and first graders that don't listen and don't know the concept of the game. And if you've ever seen those videos or those movies or anything where the image of the ball player hitting the ball at home base but running to third base in the opposite direction, or running towards first but not wanting to get tagged, so they start running all over the field, that's a typical Saturday in my life at this moment. And I've enjoyed it. I've really enjoyed getting to coach those kids. And they had a game yesterday while I was flying out, so my wife was doing the FaceTime thing with me. And she was showing the kids and showing me from the field. And it's so neat to see where they start out at with no concept of how to play baseball, to then see what 8 weeks later, what they look like by way of being able to throw and catch and be able to hit and be able to kind of understand three outs and a batting order and first base. And it's just so neat to see them learn the fundamentals of the game. And that's exactly what we're trying to teach them, is the basic fundamentals of the game. This would be no strange thought to you because you live here in Phoenix, or even if you live down in Tucson, no doubt. If you lived in Florida tonight, or you've been to Florida, this would not be a strange idea for you. There's a thing that happens most every spring unless there's a lockout for the Major League Baseball teams, and that is called, anybody know? Spring training. Spring training. Yeah, you've all probably heard of it, haven't you? They all come in for those couple of weeks or maybe several months, maybe for some, and they come in. And what are they doing? Are they learning how to play the game? Hopefully not at the professional level. They're not learning how to play the game. But what are they doing? Oh, well, they're getting in shape. Well, shouldn't they already be in shape for the millions and millions of dollars that they earn? Sure. But what are they doing? They're working on the fundamentals of the game. You're with me. They're working on the fundamentals of the game. You know what I believe sometimes you and I need to do is we need to have our own spring training. We need to go back to maybe some of the basics of the Christian life and just hit that reset button and just remind ourselves of what it is to be a Christian. Now, I'm not going to ask you in this setting tonight just for sake of time who's been saved for how much length of time, but we see it all the time in the Bible college level of a student that will come to college that maybe made a profession of faith when they were younger in a junior church or a vacation Bible school, but they were just kind of living off of mom and dad's coattails, or maybe they had, like my own personal testimony, they had a head knowledge of who God is, but they didn't have a heart knowledge or that relationship with God. And it's not uncommon to see a Bible college student in their first and even sometimes even a second year that gets saved. Hey, we had a staff member that just recently got the assurance of their salvation at Lancaster Baptist Church. That's awesome. Well, how does that happen? It happens when sometimes we just get back to the basics and we stop trying to meet the list or the demands of maybe our self-imposed religiosity, and we get back to what does it mean to be a Christian. Well, I believe that's what the Lord Jesus Christ was giving those followers that day. He was giving them a discipleship class. He was giving them like basic Christianity, like, hey, this is totally different than anything you've ever learned or seen. Hey, if they poke you, don't poke them back. That's different than what you and I would hear. And so he hits the reset button and he gives them the basics, or he puts them back to the foundation or the fundamentals of the faith. And you might be sitting there going, yeah, I think I know what the fundamentals are, and I think I know what I should do. I mean, I should read my Bible. How many of you think that's a fundamental, right? Yeah, that's a pretty good fundamental. How many of you think you should pray? Yeah, we all agree on that. But that's not what we're going to talk about tonight. What? Isn't that a fundamental? Well, yeah. But I believe, as you'll see here in the text, there's some fundamental areas that we need to work on, not just specifics. Like throwing a ball is fundamental to playing baseball, but do you not throw a ball in other sports as well? And so you need to get back to those basics. And so I want you to see, with the help of the scriptures tonight, obviously, the help of the Holy Spirit, I want you to see just three quick fundamental areas of our Christian life that I believe on a Sunday night crowd that all of us could say, hey, I need to just hit the reset button. I need to go to some spring training for tonight and just get back into the basics of the Christian faith, the Christian walk with my Savior. And I want you to see that starts, first of all, in verse number six. It says simply this: blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Write this first fundamental down for those of you in the auditorium tonight, and that is simply this. The first fundamental is your appetite as a Christian. Your appetite as a Christian. The Bible simply says, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Now, we ate lunch sometime around the 1 o'clock time frame today, but guess what? I'm hungry again. I need something else to eat again. It's just kind of the natural habit of a human's body, is that you're going to run through the energy of the food that you just ate, and you're going to need some more energy. You're going to have to put some more gas in the tank, so to say, to be able to continue going. And that's what our spiritual life is also based on, is the fact that we need to have some spiritual energy, some spiritual fuel. We need to have some spiritual food to be able to continue on in our life. And we've got to then have the right appetite. We've got to hunger and thirst after the things of God. Peter said it this way in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2 and 3. as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Now, we're not talking about your dutiful devotions today. We're not talking about your meditative meditations. We're not talking about your required readings. We're talking about, do you have an appetite for the things of God, for the righteousness of God? Yes, that includes your personal devotions. Yes, that includes prayer time. Yes, that includes preaching and fellowship and opportunities just like you're getting tonight. Yes, yes, yes. But you've got to have that hungering, that thirsting, like when you first got saved. When it was like, man, Pastor, when are we going to have church again? Man, Pastor, did you know Genesis in the Bible talks about like the Lord just spoke things into existence? Whoa! We need to get back to that kind of excitement or hunger. We need to get back to that. You know why I believe so many Christians have lost that hunger? Well, I believe that maybe they're not Christians. Maybe there's not that hunger anymore because they've never truly been saved. Again, I just mentioned a staff member. I've mentioned Bible college students. I myself grew up in a good home, a good church. I went to church all the time for the first 19, 20 years of my life. Before I put the dots together that I could not just know about God, I had to know God. And so it might be that you might be sitting in this room tonight, and I'm not here to make anybody doubt their salvation. That's between you and the Holy Spirit. That's between you and a holy God. But here, can I just say this out loud? Because I was playing a game with God. I was thumbing my nose at Him. And the reason why I didn't like to go to church, the reason why I didn't like to sit in the youth group, the reason why I didn't want to go to youth rallies, the reason why I fought God about going to Bible college is because I didn't know God. I didn't have that hunger and thirsting after Him because I wasn't truly His child. Maybe tonight, maybe that's you. I don't think so for a Sunday night crowd, but could that be a possibility? Sure, maybe that's why you're not hungering and thirsting, because you've never truly been saved. But I really believe this is the reason why we don't have the hungering, the thirsting after righteousness that we should have. And if you're a parent, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. And it's simply this: because we're already full on junk food. The reason we don't have an appetite for the things of God is because we've been snacking on junk food, and we don't have any room, or we don't have the appetite for the things of God. We've got the young people over here. I know my own family. If I gave my son anything that had sugar in it, he would not be hungry for supper. He would not be hungry for dinner. He would not be hungry for breakfast. It didn't matter, because he would snack on all the unhealthy things, and therefore he wouldn't have an appetite for the good things that we want to give him, like ice cream and, you know, pizza and stuff like, no, I'm kidding. Vegetables, right? I'm supposed to say that, you know. He wouldn't have that kind of appetite. Why? Because he would be filled with something else already. Friends, can I just be blatantly honest with you tonight? The Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. Matthew chapter 24, verse number 12, the Lord said it this way: and because iniquity shall abound, because sin shall abound, because there's going to be this abounding of a sinful lifestyle, the love of many shall wax cold. Could it be tonight that the reason we're not hunkering and thirsting after righteousness is because we're watching too much TV? Could it be we're trying to fill our minds with too much news radio? Could it be that maybe we're filling our minds with too much pop psychology? Could it be that we're filling our minds with too many philosophies of this world, that we shouldn't be standing out and be different? We shouldn't be an outsider. We shouldn't be different from everybody else. We should kind of just blend together so that way our message will somehow be acceptable. And the reason we're not hungering anymore is because we're filled on all the junk food of the world. First and foremost, I just want to challenge you that if you're going to hit that reset button, you've got to get back to the fundamental, and that fundamental is just simply having the right appetite. The right appetite. But then I want you to see, secondly, the next fundamental I see here listed in the passage, and I believe you can see this as we read them, but it's going to be, secondly, your attitude. Your attitude. Look quickly, if you would, verse number 3, and these all talk about our attitude. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Verse number 4, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Verse number 5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Verse number 9 through verse number 12 talks about being a peacemaker. It talks about being persecuted, but then kind of just turning the other cheek. And it has to do with your response. It has to do with your attitude to the things that are happening to you and around you. Hey, my friends, can I just cut right to the chase here tonight? Perhaps the reason why you aren't seeing God do some things in your life personally is because you don't have an appetite for God like you should. You're not hungry and thirsting after Him. Or it might be because your attitude stinks tonight. It could be that your attitude is selfish. It could be that your attitude is filled with self. It could be that your attitude is just, well, how many of you have ever seen those Snicker commercials, right? You're just not yourself when you're hungry, you know, kind of a thing, and the commercial has some totally different person that turns into a totally different person once they eat the Snickers bar kind of a thing, and it totally changes their perspective or their personage or who they are. Hey, how many of us have been a little bit irritable at times that we've been hungry and we turn into a monster, or well, we turn into somebody different than when we're hungrier, you know, and our attitude is affected by our appetite? Are you starting to put the pieces together? We're not having the appetite for the things of God like we should. And because we're not feasting on the Word of God, because we're not filling our minds and our hearts with the truth of God's Word, we're being allowed to just eat the junk of this world, and it's starting to affect our health, and it's starting to affect our attitude. And therefore, our attitude is not wanting to be a peacemaker. Our attitude is, you poked me, I'm going to poke you. I'm going to get even with you. You cut me off in traffic, I'm going to cut you off, or I'm going to tailgate you. I was doing a little bit of that, I have to confess, on our way here. And man, it happens, doesn't it? Even to good Christians. Well, where does that happen? Because somewhere back here we weren't doing the right thing, so now it's affecting something down the line. I know who I'm talking to tonight. I know I'm talking to a Sunday night crowd. I know that you're here, and most likely you have a testimony of God's grace in your own personal life. But could there be the possibility that maybe your attitude is being affected because of your appetite? See where this is all kind of going? Then I want you to see the last one, and it talks about it as we are to be the salt of the earth. It talks about it as we are to be the light of the world. And that's just, to sum it up, just simply the fundamental you can write down is simply this: your actions. Your actions as a Christian. Man, you can see the chain reaction, can't you? Your appetite's not what it should be. You're not feasting on the Word of God, the things of God. Therefore, your attitude stinks, and everybody around you, you're kind of irritable against. You're not a peacemaker. You're not at peace with them. You're not meek and humble towards them. You want your way or the highway. And we can even start to rub even our spouse the wrong way because of our attitude that stinks, because we haven't been feasting on the things of God. And that only then leads to that third area that we're talking about, which is our actions. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Our attitude leads to our actions. Eventually, what we are on the inside is going to come out on the outside. And could it be tonight that you and I all need to go through some spring training? We need to get back to eating a proper diet of the Word of God, of feasting upon the manna that He has to offer for us on a daily basis. Could it be then that that would alter our attitude tonight, so that we might be able to be the salt and the light of the earth that is in need of us tonight? Because if we don't do something, imagine what the generation is that those kids are going to grow up in. Imagine the generation that your grandkids are going to grow up in, or my kids are going to grow up in. Are they even going to know the same America that you and I have been privileged to know if we don't go back to the basics and get some things right, so that we can have a greater testimony and a greater effectiveness for God, because our actions are going to be the salt and the light of the earth. Tonight, I wonder if you just maybe need to get back to the basics tonight. And I'm not talking about just a check mark that, hey, I read my devotions today. I'm talking about hungering and thirsting after God. Because if you do that and you come with an open heart and a ready mind to hear from God, God will bless that. God will speak to you. God will help you then to get to a place where you are full on the blessings and the Word of God, and your attitude is going to be affected by that, and therefore then your actions are going to be affected by that, and everybody around you is going to know there's something different about you. Man, there's something different. I can't put my finger on it, but man, your actions have been different. You've been like a servant. Like, it's not about you for some reason. Like, man, even your attitude. when you pulled out of the driveway this morning, you didn't honk at me as I was walking across the street. Like even your attitude was different. And all of a sudden, God's going to be able to use that as the salt and light of the earth to see something great happen. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a simple message tonight. But sometimes that's what we need, isn't it? So here's the question. How are your actions? Oh, wait, let's go back a step. How's your attitude? Maybe that starts with how's your appetite? Are you feasting on the things of God? With heads bowed and eyes closed tonight. Father, it's a privilege to be able to stand here tonight and to be able to speak to these dear people. Lord, I know that we've got some spiritual warriors in this room tonight. Lord, to hear the testimonies of those that came here to plant this church, to hear of a pastor and his wife here visiting, and to, Lord, even to preach to Bible college students and to preach even to myself tonight, Lord, that we all just need to stop and just hit that reset button and make sure that we're still doing the basics right. Not that we're just going through the motions, but Lord, that we have the right heart and the right motivations. And so, Lord, I pray that you'd help tonight. However this message hit a heart, Lord, I pray that you would use that to just maybe start a spark of revival in their heart and life. And Lord, if that would help this church, or if that would help another church, or if that would even help the Bible college students as they go from church to church and place to place, Lord, how I pray that we would get back to the fundamentals. Lord, we love you. We thank you for loving us. And Lord, I pray that you'd bless now this time of invitation, for it's in thy Son's precious name. I don't know how you normally would do it, but I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet, and I'm going to ask the piano player to begin to play just quietly there. And maybe you just need to get back to the basics. Maybe you just need to hit that reset button. Maybe you just need to get something right with your attitude, or maybe your actions aren't what they should be. Well, ask yourself, does it start with your appetite? And maybe tonight, just right there at your chair, maybe right here at the front of this altar area, maybe tonight you just like to speak unto the Lord and get some things maybe settled in your heart and life. Maybe you're doing great. Maybe you're doing just fine. Well, sometimes we just need to be reminded of the basics. So however the Lord dealt with you, I encourage you in these few moments together that you pray and you ask the Lord to do something great and to make that commitment unto him, and then our pastor will come and he'll close the service in just a few moments. But whatever it is that you need to deal with, I pray that you would do that tonight and get back to the basics.
Piano is still playing. You should still continue to do some business with the Lord. Tell our church all the time during invitation, that's why we're here. Take as much time as you need. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word tonight, how it was delivered, how it challenged us. Such simple truth, and yet right on point. Our attitudes, just like what we were preaching about this morning, pray that our attitude is pleasing to you. It starts with our appetite and filtering out the things of this world and having an affection for the things above. When those things are in their right place, then our actions can be lived out accordingly, so we can be that salt, so we can be the light of the world. If the salt has lost its savor, wherewith can it be seasoned and used for good? And God, so may we not lose our distinctiveness, the characteristics of a child of the King. And that starts with having the right attitude, getting back to the basics, the right appetite as well. Lord, thank you for this message tonight, how it's helped us. And I pray you'd give us the grace to go forth and apply these principles this week. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. And we had a visiting family came to our church this morning, and it was such a blessing to talk with them afterwards. They had spent some time in another church and said, you know, we appreciate the message. We wanted to find somewhere where we could get a good message, but we could get good music too. And they said, we went on your website, and one of the pictures we saw on there, we saw you had a piano. And we looked at more on your website, and there wasn't anything else. And so we said, if it's got to be a piano, it's got to be good. So let's go check out the church.
And just the man was sitting right over here, just smiling the whole time. And he said, this is the most traditional church we've been in a long time. And he said, service today was just so refreshing. And I told him, I said, you know, we just try to love people, and we just try to preach the Bible. And so, yes, we have a piano, we have psalm books, and we have chairs, but most importantly, we have the Bible, just the basic things. And yet, it's amazing how God still uses that with the right appetite and the right spirit, right attitude, still to be refreshing, still to be a blessing to people. And I was thinking about that as Brother Blehm was preaching, and what a challenge, what a help for us tonight, right what we needed, exactly what we needed. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here tonight as well. This time I'm going to ask the Harvest Trio and the group if they wouldn't mind going by their table there. And had a wonderful opportunity. Talked a lot about Wednesday night, about what that table is and how we can be a blessing to them. Well, I will say this, and I don't know if you've ever had this in your experience in the tour group. I'm going to say one item to not purchase, because our church is going to go ahead and purchase it for you, okay? So he was talking about the Outsiders book. I have read that book. It is a tremendous book. And so it's my fault for not getting with you ahead of time before he promoted it. But to let you in on the insiders here. We're going to, tonight, our church is going to purchase one copy for all of the men in our church, our regular attendees, our membership. And so we're really going to hand that out on Father's Day here in a couple of weeks. And I second everything that he said about that book. Just a tremendous, tremendous insight into our Baptist history, our forefathers. And so I can just about vouch for everything else that's on that table as well. Some of those things are new to me as well. And so you will not find a bad resource. All of that will be a help to you on the table. But don't get the Outsiders book, because we're going to go ahead and get it for you tonight as well. So I will say this, church family. I know, like we normally do, we have a lot to stack and put up here. You always do a wonderful job of that. This can wait. And so please go to the table first, talk to the college students, check out the table and the resources there, tell them how much we appreciated them. Church, if you received the blessing from the Harvest Trio and them being with us tonight, would you say amen? And we sure did as well. Thank you so much for being here. So good to have you with us. Lord willing, we'll be back in our home Bible study this coming Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. And as we mentioned, it's so good to have Pastor Hoffer with us, visiting from Prescott. Would you mind just lifting your voice, brother, and closing us in a word of prayer tonight?